Good. So my name is Baptiste. You probably know me from the local team, but I'm also part of a community network in France. So I'm going to talk a bit broadly about the situation in France, because we know that we don't communicate a lot to the outside world because of language and lots of things. So this will be like a summary, mostly centered on the Fédération FDN, which is like, for us, the main organization for community networks in France. I mean, there are other ones, but I'm not part of them, so I can't talk a lot about them. Let's go. So just an overview of like the past. So it's more general than community networks, but it's important to understand what we do. So there's a big free software community in France that has been active since 1996, so quite old. So April is the main free software association in France that promotes free software, that does some legal action, some teaching and so on. They have a few employees. There's a second association doing kind of the same thing, which is a local chapter of the Free Software Foundation. It's a bit more recent and smaller, but they are kind of complementary. So there's a big idea about free software here. You probably know about the RMLL, Rencontre Mondiale du Logiciel Libre, which always happened in France, but it's still a worldwide event. It happened once in Geneva and once in Brussels, but otherwise it's mostly like local free software community organizing this event. It changes location from time to time. It's been running for almost 20 years, so quite a well-known event at this point. And it's starting to be more general, like there's talks on infrastructure, on lots of stuff, but mostly related to free software. And actually, this is where our community networks started to organize, so this is important. There's another entity, Framasoft, which started like also in the beginning of the 2000s, and it was mostly like so it's also about free software, but more generally free culture also, and it started as a popular education with a popular education goal in mind. Like the founders, they were like math teachers and so on, so they were interested in computer science and technology, but it was not the main. Their main occupation, basically. And so now Framasoft is like a big actor. They promote a lot free software from a like usability point of view. Like we want everybody to use free software and free tools. So they make it very easy to install some services. So basically, so they have tens of services that they run. They all call Frama something. So like Framapad is just Etherpad. Framadate is something you can use to plan meetings with people. Framagit and so on. And their focus is really on like they provide these services for free so that people can switch from Google services to more respectful services. But they also encourage you to deploy your own services. Okay? They don't want to become the next Google and so on. So for every service, they explain you, okay, this service is nice, you can use it, but it's running this software, and here's how you can install it yourself, you know, to empower people. Since a few years, they started some big campaigns, like the De-Googleize Internet campaign, to take this like a level further. And then more recently, Contributopia, because they started to realize that, okay, they promote a lot of free software, but nobody is contributing to these softwares, you know? And some of them are just dying because maybe there's one people working on it and it doesn't have time and so on. So they try to, they organize camps, they try to really get people involved to, contribute to all these software so that they can survive. And even more recently, you may have heard of PeerTube, which is like YouTube, it's like YouTube, but you can install it on your own server, and it's distributing video in a peer-to-peer fashion, a bit like the player from the live stream here. So Framasoft funded the development of this tool, and I mean, just look at it, it's easy to use, it works, and I mean, it's a really switching from YouTube to this platform is possible and people do it. So it's starting to be a big thing. And it's also using ActivityPub, like what Paul presented. So it can interact with Mastodon and so on. So it's really part of this Fediverse thing. And then there's a new project on the roadmap, Mobilizen, which is like an alternative to Meetup, like to organize events and so on. Basically, the idea is to get people away from Facebook for events. So it's like really, really active, this organization, and we work a lot with them. Okay, so it's a bit broad. La Quadrature du Net. So now we're more in the advocacy side. So the goal of La Quadrature du Net is to defend fundamental freedoms, like, yeah, fundamental freedoms in general, but mostly applied to the internet and the digital world. So they do a lot of action around censorship, around surveillance, around all this kind of... so both in the context of the state, so surveillance laws, like anti-terrorism law that allows the government to censor websites without any oversight and so on. So they fight this kind of thing. But also surveillance by private actors, okay, like Google, Amazon, and so on. If you know about EFF and Bits of Freedom in the Netherlands, it's kind of the same kind of organization. So it's starting, 10 years old. They got some big victories at the European level. If you know about ACTA, it was like 6-7 years ago. It was like an international treaty. It's an anti-counterfeiting trade agreement. And it was like basically taking copyright to the next level. And it was really, really bad. And basically, La Quadrature du Net coordinated a big action at the European level to just defeat this treaty. And it worked. Like the European Member of Parliament, they listened to La Quadrature and other organizations. And they just refused to endorse this treaty. So that was the most, the biggest victory for La Quadrature. It's also active on the network neutrality side. So that's where we have a common ground, basically. And also, so this is like always fighting against something. And now, since a few years, they also try to push a positive agenda, like not always saying, oh, this is bad, we should not do it, but also say like, oh, let's do this instead, you know, alternatives, like promote decentralized networks like Mastodon and so on. That's it. And they always need some money. So if you like what they do, just give them money. It just helps them survive, basically. Okay, so now we're more going into the network side. So the first emanation of mesh networks, community network in France, was called RAN, for Rural Area Network. So it's a joke around man and so on. So it started at the time where Wi-Fi was becoming widespread, so in the early 2000s. DSL was coming, but not everywhere. So basically, they were deploying some small Wi-Fi network to use one DSL connection and share it with some people. And you all know how this works. It has not disappeared, but it's a lot more active now, a lot less active now, sorry. There are a few networks still working. Some of these actors, they change to small companies to do the same thing. And we don't have a lot of relationship with those people because like they're not really interested in the political questions like network neutrality and so on. So, I think in Teta Neutral in Toulouse, you have some links, but...
We know the people from... Yeah, there is a small company nearby. We try to not interfere with them and not stealing their clients. And,
okay.
And when someone from this area comes, we send them to the existing run.
Okay.
That's
it. So, I'm not part of this, so that's all I can tell about this project. So now, FDN. So FDN is basically the founding member of the Fédération FDN. So FDN means French Data Network. And it's a non-profit ISP that started in 1992, like 27 years ago, almost my age. Yeah. And fun fact, it's the oldest ISP in France still in activity. Okay, there were some ISP before, but since then they died or were bought or whatever. FDN is the oldest still running today. So it's quite something. So they started providing internet access through RTC, modems, and so on at the time. And the goal was basically to share some news group. Like basically the founder at the time had a server in his bedroom, and he was like calling in the night to the US to get some news group. And then people from their station will connect to his server to get the news group so that they don't have to pay the long distance fee for the telephone network. So. But then DSL came around. It took some years before FDN could operate on these DSL networks. So FDN almost died at this point, but then it started again, mostly because people were more interested in the political questions, like around network neutrality, surveillance, and this kind of thing. If you know, in Berlin, in Germany, quite similar. And so besides the political questions, one of the interests for people using this session to connect is that like it's very custom. I mean, if you want several IP addresses, yeah, sure, we can do it. If you want some very specific stuff, it's always possible. So it's one of the for some people, it's one of the drivers to subscribe to this kind of network. So now, at some point in 2019, I think, FDN was starting to grow in size. Like it had 300 members, 400 members all over France, and it was becoming really difficult to do that on volunteer time. Okay, like just handling support, getting people to come for the general assemblies, like from all over France, it was starting to be quite difficult. So FDN started what we called SMH in French, so swarming. Like the idea is to say, instead of concentrating everything in a single association, in a single infrastructure, and so on, let's just explain you how it works, and you do the same in your own city. Okay. So this happened at the Rencontre Mondiale du Logiciel Libre. That's why it's important, because it gathered basically all people that were interested in this kind of network, and the federation was created at this time, and I think it was. I'm not sure if it's 7, 8, or 9 different associations that went together to create this federation. I mean, these are like the early adopters of this swarming model, basically. It's a bit theoretical, but I will go into more practical details now. So this is a map that we have. So basically, the blue dots are all the members from the federation. And the orange ones are like projects, but nothing really working yet. I mean, people that are interested, but not yet at the stage of providing network access. So you see, it's like all over France. We have one in Belgium, and we have one in the Caribbean. There's a French island in the Caribbean, and there's a member here. It does not fit on the map. So yeah.
Island?
Saint Martin, if I know. It's called, what's the name?
Iguan, not
yeah. So we have 30 members. So the members of the federation are themselves ISPs and non-profit ISPs. And overall, it's like 4,000 people like that are connected or that support somehow these initiatives. So some of these ISPs are very small, some are quite big. It's really like, yeah, what's interesting for us is that we have a lot of diversity. Okay, you cannot find two of them that do exactly the same thing in the same way. It's like they adapt to the local context, they have their way of meetings, of taking decisions. It's like, big diversity. Yeah?
I see some points out of France.
Sorry?
I
think some of those markers are out of France.
Yeah.
Germany, Belgium.
Yeah, in fact, there is as well organization from all over that mark themselves. Like on the map, you have Freifunk in it. So those are such type as well outside of France. You have those organizations that have as their own map.
So yeah, basically, this tool is like open. Like if you have an initiative that, so we call that DIY ISPs at the time. We started this initiative in at the Chaos Communication Camp or Congress, I don't remember, some years ago, Congress, yeah. And basically if you have like a community ISP of some kind, you can just register on the map and put some information, how many members do you have, how can people contact you. And the idea is that like if I live here, I look at the closest one and then I send an email, you know. So most of the points are like in France because we started this, but some people outside also added some information.
Part of the federation itself,
but no, if you look, the orange one outside of the federation, yeah. Either because it's just a project or because like it's not in France. So, I mean,
the guy in Belgium over there?
Belgium is Neutrinet. It's in Brussels.
And they are part of the federation.
Because it's a French-speaking part of the country. So basically, we do everything in French. So it only makes sense to be a member if you speak French, basically.
But there are different laws and different taxes and different services.
Which is very useful sometimes. not for taxes, but... fun fact. So we do, we do some legal actions, like to when there is a law that tells us, like all ISPs should keep a lot of data about their users and so on, and we don't want to do this. So we just challenge these laws at the Supreme Court in France, basically. And at some point, like we were too late because there was a 1 month delay so that you could attack this. But there's an exception, like if you are outside of France, there's a longer delay. I don't remember if it's Iguane or Neutrinet. Iguane. So basically, because we had a member outside of France, we could say, okay, the longer delay applies to us, and we can still attack this law. So, yeah, diversity is very interesting in some cases. Okay, so now I will present like 3 or 4 of our members very quickly to see the different models. So Tetantral is in Toulouse. I started quite some time ago, maybe 10 years ago. Yeah.
2010,
yeah. Yeah, from the beginning of the federation. So it's mostly doing like radio. It's Wi-Fi, but we call that radio, by the way. And they have like 200 subscribers, so half of it in Toulouse, in the city, and half of it in the countryside outside of Toulouse. They do some fiber. Like there was a collaborating housing project, like with 80 apartments in the same building, and people like want to know each other and so on. It's just not everybody on its own apartment, and basically, like 55 out of the 80 apartments took the fiber from Tetantral. So it. Yeah. But this is like very specific cases where we can do this kind of thing. There's a big part of Tetantral which is related to DIY hosting, basically. So they have a data center in hacker space, artistic space. Similar to this place, where they host like 100 physical machines. So it can go from Raspberry Pis, old laptops, NUC, whatever. Just come with it, plug it, and you have gigabit internet, public IP address, and like 200 virtual machines for people, projects, whatever. And they also have some projects like the GCC compiled farm. They have some mirrors for OpenStreetMap, Tay Store, LineageOS, whatever. Like when you have this kind of infrastructure, it's easy to help other projects basically, because this is one of the biggest members of the federation. Okay. Now, Scani, that's also one of the biggest members. It's very different. This is in a rural area of France, like southeast of Paris, in Bourgogne, Burgundy. that's the only member of the federation that is not an association in French law. It's a cooperative for various reasons. I won't go into details. So basically, they deploy Wi-Fi networks in villages in the whole area. They have some fiber backhaul to connect everything together. They use this infrastructure. So they have like 700 connected homes, which is quite big. They put some open access points, like in town hall and so on. It's mostly paid by the local authority. They say, oh, it's nice. So it's a local cooperative. Let's do it. And like 1,000 users every day. And like the governance model is quite, well thought and well structured. They spent a lot of time thinking about how do we take decisions, who can take which kind of decisions. Yeah, Pedro?
The legal form evolved from an association, non-profit association, to a cooperative,
yeah,
where they are thinking a lot about the for-profit, or how to pay people to do jobs by having volunteers. So it's a very interesting evolution that we should...
Yeah. I know what you talked with Stayou. So basically, so for French law, it's a company, but like the way it is run, it's really a cooperative for non-profit. So, I mean, all profit is reinvested in the infrastructure and so on. So yeah, it's a quite interesting governance model, basically. There was somebody from Scani yesterday. They were doing the fiber splicing workshops. So Aquilonet, now this one is in Bordeaux, southeast of France. They don't do so much networking. Basically, they just provide, it's already something interesting, but they provide DSL access using the FDN infrastructure. And they mostly do like server hosting, a lot of projects with local other nonprofits. Like there's a network of independent cinemas, which is a kind of well known in France. And Southwest, sorry. Like basically, with these cinemas, they deployed the solution to distribute the movies for the screening using BitTorrent. It's like, and they call that the DCP Bay, because DCP is a format of the digital movies for cinemas. So it's a joke about the Pirate Bay. So yeah, they have some interesting projects, and they have also a meeting space, where there are some Raspberry Pi servers and so on. And they work with other nonprofits. Last one, Illico, much smaller. All these were kind of the big ones. Illico is like, on the Wi-Fi network, maybe 20, 30 people. I'm not exactly sure how many. It's in Corrèze, so very like only small villages and small cities, no big city. And yeah, there's this interesting story about Tarnac that the French people probably know in this room. And basically, they lobbied Orange, the incumbent operator, to bring a fiber into the central office of the village, which is like quite isolated. And now, Illico can provide VDSL in the whole village. So yeah, it's kind of an interesting local action. That's it. So now, you see, we have very different approaches to how to do networking, what kind of service we provide. So, but we have a federation, okay? So we have to have some common principles that everybody agrees on. So basically, we have a charter. It's on the website in French, sorry. and basically, if you want to become a member of the federation, you have to agree about this chart, this charter. So basically, very condensed, but you have to defend the basic principle of the internet, like the network neutrality. You should not decide what kind of content is more important than other, except for technical reasons, but otherwise that's not your role as an ISP. You have to provide public IP addresses, so that people can host some services on their connection. IPv6, if you can. Then the way the association works must be democratic. Like, every subscriber must have a voice, must be able to come to the General Assembly to have his opinion and take part in the decision. Obviously, not everybody does that, but it must be possible. The board of the association must be elected. Then all the benefits, they cannot be distributed to the board or something, obviously. It has to be reinvested in the infrastructure. And then there is a duty of solidarity. So both with people, so if somebody does not know how to configure a router, you should help these people to do it. And there's also solidarity between members of the federation. Okay, so yeah, at some point, some of the members have some maybe legal troubles or want to have big projects and they need money, or they need technical support, or they need something. And then we try to have all the members help each other to go in the same direction, basically. That's it. So some example of more political actions. So Femaison in Nantes, Romanek, yeah, he's here. they do a lot of conferences, like really to reach people that don't know about this project and to tell them about the political impact, why maybe you don't trust the big ISPs and so on. I think they helped setting up a network in this ZAD in Notre-Dame-des-Landes, where there was an opposition to airport construction. And it was really like the police came several times to move people out and so on. So Tetra Central connects squats for free in Toulouse. A lot of our members, they organize movie screenings, like Nothing to Hide, Hackers 1-0 about what happened in the Catalonia election, and so on. A lot of our members do pay what you want schemes. Like, if you don't have a lot of money, you pay less, and if you have more money, you can pay more, so that it still works economically speaking. Yeah, but some example of political actions. So, this is a side project, not to say that it's not important, but to say that it started a bit inside the Federation. The Brick Internet Cube. Basically, it's an Olimex board with a Wi-Fi antenna, running a derivative of Debian called WhyUnohost. And members of the Federation, they sell them to people. And it's pre-configured with a VPN that connects back to the local ISP infrastructure. So that you can get... So if you don't want to take a DSL line with our infrastructure, you can just keep your fiber with Orange, SFR, whatever, and plug that on the network. It will automatically make a tunnel, give you a public IP address from the local ISP. Then you can use Wi-Fi. It will go through the VPN. You can host some services on it, your emails, Jabber, whatever. And it's like the goal is to be really easy to set up. Like anybody can take it, plug it, and then there's a nice web interface and so on. So it really helped bring our messages like outside our traditional community of like computer science people and so on. So it's a nice project. Yes, Jules? The cost?
Let's speak about money.
Olimex is a bit expensive, 75 euros. And then you have to pay for the VPN connection. It's like a subscription, but it's like 5-8 euros, depends. Okay, so now some example of common actions that we do at the level of the Federation. Mostly, these are actions that are useful for all our members. So all this lobbying work at the French regulator or the European regulator, to like try to be more strict on network neutrality, to change a bit the rules on how we very small ISP we can access the infrastructure, and so on. So RCEP does a lot of public consultations, and usually there's like Facebook, Orange, and so on that reply to these consultations, so that they can say, you should do this so that I can get more money. Basically, that's it. And we have a very different kind of answer to this consultation. And so RCEP is a French regulator for telecom. They listen to us. We lack nothing in terms of number of subscribers and so on, but what we say is like, it's basically for the common good. Okay, we don't really care about our own small interests and so on. We really try to look at the big picture, and it's working because they listen to us. So with La Quadrature du Net, we work a lot with them on legal actions and so on, mostly on surveillance and data retention, like the logs that we have to keep or not, because it's important for us also. So there's a group of lawyers, volunteer lawyers, basically, that work a lot. Like they have meetings every week to look at the new laws, how we can attack them. Then we go to the, how is it called in English? Cour de justice de l'Union Européenne, like the High Court in Europe, to try to repeat some French laws about surveillance and so on. So there's a big action in this direction. Then ensure access to fiber infrastructure, we talk more about this. And then documentation, how do we share our knowledge and political values and so on with the members and the outside world. So all of these things make sense at the global level, okay? And then the members do their own actions at the local level when it makes more sense. Now, I will talk more about the technical part. Try to be brief. So basically, we want to be as independent as possible in terms of infrastructure. So most of us become like registered operators and have their own infrastructure. So basically, you need to be to have a presence in the data center, then interconnect with transit providers, exchange points, and this kind of thing. It can cost a lot of money. If you're small, it's not easy to pay for this. Like, now, I estimate it's like between 400 euros and 1,000 euros per month if you want to have this kind of core network infrastructure. So basically, we have two ways of paying for this. Either become big enough to be able to support it, or like do mutualization of costs. Like if you have a non-profit ISP in the same region, we just go together and have a single infrastructure that we share between the members. And that's what Jitoyen did quite some time ago in Paris, and Grenoble, which I'm part of, does in Lyon. Lyon, Grenoble, this area. And by the way, Jitoyen is providing the internet for the event. So just some photo. This is Grenoble's infrastructure. I mean, not everything. this is not us. I think we have a switch, some servers, basically. And it's in a big data center in Lyon, the biggest data center, basically, where you have all operators, all transit providers. So it's very easy to connect and to exchange traffic. And basically, this is provided to us by Resopol, which manages the local exchange point. And it's like also a non-profit, so they help us a lot. So then we deploy some Wi-Fi networks. So this is where I live in Grenoble. Well, I don't live here, as you can tell. But this is our main location where we see a lot of the city. And so we can provide internet access this way. A schema of the network. So you have like a core backbone with OSPF and so on. Then we have some access points on this location and other locations. And then we have subscribers that have an antenna and a home router to connect to this network. And basically, we give a public IP address to everybody here. It's like really internet access, not just, yeah.
That's Grenoble.
Grenoble, yes.
And where is the center node?
Sorry?
What area of the city? Of
Bastille.
The
city? On top of the...
And you cover the city from Bastille?
Yeah. We have some other points in other parts of the city, but the biggest one is Bastille because we have a very nice view. No, basically, we go up to 5 kilometers, 6 kilometers. Yeah. So it's not a mesh network. Sorry. So this part is routed, so yeah, it's running just OSPF. But then this part is just access points, stations, and we do DHCP between this and this, basically. That's it. This is a weather map. So we have the main routers in various parts of the cities, backbone links, like point-to-point links or fibers. And then this is where we have access points and people connect to the infrastructure at a specific point. So now we go in another location. So this is Scani, if you remember, in Bourgogne. It's like a big network. We don't have the scale, but I think this is like 200 kilometers or something. It's a huge part of Burgundy. Auxerre is here, Dijon must be like somewhere on here, and Paris is like here. I think I have another nicer map. Yeah, that's what we were discussing yesterday. So this is a view of the different subnetworks, basically. So you have 700 people connected here. Some fiber backhaul in the central locations, then some connections, radio connection between the zones, and what can I say? So basically, when they lease a fiber, a backhaul fiber, it costs quite a lot of money. So then they try to deploy their own fiber around, just to use the bandwidth that they have. But most of the network now is Wi-Fi. And they have, they try to involve the local communities as much as possible. Like in your village, in the village, there's one person which is willing to help others and so on to troubleshoot, debug, so that the people in Auxerre or Paris, they don't have to go everywhere to fix problems. Like small problems that get solved locally, and global problems get solved by the people managing the network, basically. So locally, we do a bit of fiber. So this is also in Grenoble, our first fiber on the public fiber infrastructure in Grenoble. So this was used to provide internet access to Wikimedia. They did a three-day event in Grenoble with 100 people. Like all the French community of Wikipedia came in Grenoble, and we provide them with fiber access. So it was quite... quite interesting action. And then this is a teaser for this afternoon. What I talked about is mostly what we've been doing for the last 10, 5, 2, 3 years, depends on the community. But now we are really trying to move into the FTTH, so fiber networks. So I won't go into detail because that's the goal of this afternoon, but now the government put a lot of money on the table to build some fiber infrastructure everywhere in France, except the big cities. It's like €3 billion euros for doing like 10 years, something like this. And so it's a public infrastructure, but then there are some public-private partnerships. So it's supposed to be easily accessible to small ISPs. In practice, it depends a bit. And so we spent a lot of time analyzing these public networks and like see, is it really deployed by the public local authority? Or has it been delegated to a private company? Which private company? Like when it's Orange, there's a blatant conflict of interest because they manage the infrastructure. They have to open it to all ISPs. But they are also an ISP. So they don't want anybody else to use their infrastructure. But some other infrastructure operators, they are more open, and we are now starting to operate on this network. So I will just show you quickly our tool. Yeah, this one, let's say. So basically, for each region in France, we look at the situation of this public FTTH network. And so this map shows the infrastructure operator. So orange is orange, so that's the worst ones, basically. green is Axion, which nobody knows about because they're just doing infrastructure. They don't provide directly internet access. They just lease the network to ISPs. So this one is quite reasonable. Then there's Altitude, Covage, whatever. In a few locations, the local authority did the network themselves. Like it's a régie in French, direct. Yeah, basically, like the local electricity utility, they also laid some fiber and they operate it. But it's like in just a few cases. And for each of the region, we give a grade, like, oh, can we operate this easily? Or is it like completely expensive? Or is it technically impossible? So basically, there's a single location where it's really possible. The yellow ones are OK, but a bit expensive. And then all the other ones are like, OK, with the current state of the way they sell access to the network, it's just impossible for us. So we talk more about this afternoon. So I will conclude with this. And yeah, come this afternoon at 2 p.m. We will have a talk by somebody from the public side of this FTTH project. And then we'll have a panel to discuss how does it work, what are the advantages, the issues, and so on. So that's it. Thank you. So maybe a few questions. Yeah, Paul?
I'm sure you said it, but what was the historical reason for the federation to start?
Oh, because FDN was starting to get to be too big.
In terms of
number of people, of...
centralized in one place.
Yeah, like there was a single infrastructure, so if it fails, nothing works in this network anymore. And like, FDN is starting in Paris and near Paris, but people can connect with DSL from the other side of France. So it's very hard to meet each other, to discuss and so on. So we thought it would be much better to have like local ISPs so that you can meet, explain how it works and so on, without having to travel all the way to Paris or somewhere else. Yeah, yeah, it's a technical side and human side. Yeah. Yeah.
So in all these experiences, there's a gamma of approaches. From I reflash everything myself, and I run only free software. To I buy Ubiquiti devices and Cisco routers, but I offer a service to my people.
Yeah.
And where do more or less the experience are in this gamma?
It really depends on the number. So like Scani, Resin, my community. We just use the Ubiquiti software because, I mean, it works, it's very easy, it's cheap. And but then on the router, we run free software. And some of the members, like in the one in Alsace, Alsace Réseau Neutre, they're really in this direction, like flashing everything, only open WRT and so on. So yeah, it depends.
So but you have also like hacking teams and hacking experiences. And not only small operators in the federation.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Yeah.
You didn't mention that they have great information systems.
Ah, yeah.
That open source, so systems that allows you to manage the association and all the stuff related.
And the subscribers, and yeah. Yeah, we developed some software to help us. And maybe, I try to talk a bit about this tomorrow. Like we wrote tools to be able to tell, like, okay, where do you live in the city? Okay, we took some panoramic photos from all our main nodes, and so we try to see, okay, in the photo, can we see your house? And this kind of thing to make it easier to see if it's possible or not to connect people. I mean, we do, like, what I was saying is that we can really be specific to the local environment and the need of the people and write some custom tools. Because like, yeah, we live in the in this location and...
There are tools like BirdLG, which was written by a member of Theta Neutral and is now used by many network operators to provide the looking glass for BGP. They are running Bird because BirdLG is nice, you can do a lot of nice graphs.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah, it's a looking glass for Bird, but we, but yeah, a member of Theta Neutral wrote. And I think now Tata is using it,
yes, Tata,
OVH.
Tata, OVH, I use this. It's free software. It was developed because at Tata we wanted something better than the text-based looking glass that is available with the...
Yeah.
What is it called?
BirdLG.
LG.
Like looking glass.
Like your renders. What was the license of this?
It's GPL or IGPL, I don't remember.
Yeah.
But it's free software.
And that means that Theta Neutral is running Bird.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Most, I mean, I think all our members are running like they're not using Cisco router.
Maybe Scandi.
Maybe Scandi. I think they're using Mikrotik routers. But mostly we use like a server using Debian or whatever OS, and we do everything in software using
but
Bird.
You prefer Bird to
Quiet?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I'm not a specialist there, but
we can discuss that if you want.
There are probably also just historical parts. When we started, Bird was not more active.
Okay. One last question, Daniele.
Yeah. Just. A very important point for our federation is that the first value we recognize ourselves in is volunteering.
Yeah,
and even though our several different members at the organization level might, in, at the end of the year, have gained some money, we are all non-profit.
Yeah, so Scani, one of the biggest ones, is paying people like, to deploy antennas and so on. But
it's not getting profit.
Yeah.
Out of the company.
Yeah. And most of the work
paying,
is volunteering.
Somebody eventually, which is kind of rare, doesn't happen very often, is not yet being a for-profit company.
Yeah. But I mean, you can pay people without being a for-profit company. In France, we don't really like to touch money, but yeah.
To Yishanong from LA, from Transoft.
Yeah.
We are promoting free software for hosting services, and you're doing the same, but for ISP.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but as you see, Chaton is a project from Transoft to really like start very very small hosting providers, non-profit, like for your family, your friends, maybe a bit more, so that. It's part of their efforts to not host all the services themselves, to tell people to do it. And we are doing the same thing for networking. But as you've seen, some of our members also host some services. So you know, it's not like a clear separation. There's an overlap at some point.
The hosting services that we provide at Theta Neutral, for example, are used by many chatons to host services. We just provide the virtual machines, the network, and that's it. And they install the operating system, the applications, and so on about that.
Yeah, so basically, we mostly do the infrastructure, and then some of them do services, but like the central services done by somebody else, a chaton or whatever. Yeah.
And it's often complementary from the chaton and the ISP, like we have in Compiègne, we have both association in our university, and so we're really complementary and doing opening. Like we talk to each other and like organize the conference with both associations, and so you still have some discussion between them. But it's mostly we do some infrastructure and data service, but you have some little services that we host for. Or usage, often like that. So it's a special, and they go locally on
the actor of the prison.
What was the story behind the fiber connection to this building?
This building.
Yes.
Yeah, I won't explain that now. I will explain it at the closing session. Yeah. Because we managed to get fiber to this building for the event and operated by Jitoyen, which is one of our members. So it's quite a nice story, but I will tell it tomorrow. I think we have to go to eat. Thank you again.